Hello. Today we're going to be talking about subspaces and vector spaces. Essentially, a subspace is a vector space, but instead of proving all 10 properties of a vector space, if we have a subset of a known vector space, then we only have to prove essentially two conditions to show that something is a subspace. So the definition of a subspace would be if W is a non-empty subset of a vector space V, so we have some sort of subset of a bigger space that we already know is a vector space, then W is a subspace of V if and only if the following closure conditions hold. So essentially, the set is going to be closed under scalar addition, under vector addition, and it's going to be closed under scalar multiplication. So if you take two elements in the set and you add them together, and that's also in the set, then that's closure under vector addition. And if you take a vector in the set and any scalar, you multiply those together and that's in the set, then that's closure under scalar multiplication. So we're going to be looking at a couple of examples here. We want to determine if the following set W is a subspace of V, which is R3. So with the standard operation. So that's just vector addition and scalar multiplication as we know it. So this one, of course, has three components, but they have to look like this. So it has to be S, some value S, and then S minus another value, and then T, so another value, all in that set. So things in that set might look like, for instance, if S was 1 and T was 0, we would have 1, 1, 0 in there. If S was 0 and T was 1, we would have 0, -1, 1 in there. So things that look like that would be in our subspace. Sometimes it's easy to prove something isn't a subspace if we look at the zero vector and it's not in there. So that's sort of the question I ask first. So is that 0, 0, 0 vector in W? Well, it is, because if you let S and T both equal 0, and we have control because S and T are real numbers, then 0, 0, 0 is of that form, and it's in W. So this does have the 0 vector in there, so we can sort of check that off in our list and say, yep, 0, 0, 0 is in there. So this is sort of a step that you don't need to show, but if you think, especially if something isn't a vector space, then that would probably be a good thing to show. Okay, so the next thing we look at is, of course, if U and V are in there, is U plus V in there? So we let U and V look like the set. So essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to take U to equal S1, S1 minus T1, and T1. And V to be S2, S2 minus T2, and T2, where those are just arbitrary real numbers, and consider their sum. So I have the sum set up here, U plus V. Of course, we combine those together by adding them element-wise. And then, to show that it looks like something up here that we started with, what we can do is we can combine the S's together and the T's together, and then I strategically factor out that negative. So when I get down to this point right here, I notice that this has the same form as the starting point. And to do that, to show that even more clearly, I'll just let S, another variable, equal the sum of the S's, and T equal the sum of the T's. So now you can see that that's exactly like what we started with. So yes, we do have closure under vector addition. So the last thing we want to show is going to be this scalar multiplication. So if U is in there and C is a scalar, then show the scalar multiples in there. That's step three. So again, I'm just going to let U equal that same thing, and it's going to be in W, so I'm going to consider U or CU. So C filters in to the vector, just like we've learned in the past. So we have to take C times every component, And then I distribute in, so I can regroup, reassociate here, distribute the second one in, and reassociate here. And in the end, if I let S equals C S1 and T equals C T1, I can do that because they're just real numbers. Then again, we have this exact same form that we started out with right here at the start. So that is really our last checklist. So really we only have to show those two things, but we've shown the zero vectors in there too. So we've essentially shown that W is a subspace and therefore a vector space in its own right. So it's easier to show something's a subspace than to have to show all those 10 properties. Let's look at another one. So here we have, let's look at this vector in R2 defined by all ordered pairs X and Y such that X minus Y is equal to 1. So that has to hold where V is equal to R2. So we're going to see if this is a subspace of the vector space R2. We know that R2 is a vector space. So the first thing to look at is the zero vector. Well, if I want to get 0, 0 in there, X and Y both have to be 0. So let's just let X be 0. If X is 0, then by using this equation here, Y has to be equal to a negative 1. And 0, negative 1 is not in W, so that doesn't work. Well, another way to try it would be to let y equal 0. And if y is equal to 0, you can see that x is forced to be 1 to make this equation hold. So 1 minus 0 is 0. So the punchline here is we can see that no matter what values of x and y we take, as long as they have to satisfy this definition, which they do, that it's not going to be a subspace. So this one, we showed that since 0, 0 is not in there, it's not going to be a subspace of R2. Of course, you could show the same thing with scalar multiplication. That would work as well. It would violate that premise as well. And most likely, vector addition as well. It would probably violate that as well because you wouldn't get something that satisfies this equation. Well, I hope this example's helped. Thank you.